Table Football Monthly? Don't mind if I do.
Table Football Monthly.
Hello, hello, and welcome to the September edition of Table Football Monthly. And yes, I know we have gently tiptoed into October, but we have delayed this edition on purpose because we have some truly jolly and very groovy news to share with you later in the programme. But first of all, here we all are at the start of another football season. Well, not quite yet another, because we've never had one like it before. We've got goals flying in. Left, right and centre, but no one in the stadiums to see them. We've got VAR still managing to cock everything up, so nothing's changed since last season. And we have something new. Now it would appear, if the ball touches any part of your body in a game, it's handball. So how nice is it that we can all sit here for an hour and wallow in some fluffy, comforting, simple footy nostalgia?
Talking of nostalgia, the muddy pitches have arrived.
Yay!
They are here on site, ready to be packaged up and sent out to anybody who would like one.
We'll be giving you the details about this muddy pitch later on, when they'll be ready and how much they are going to cost. So stay with us for that.
And there's more. My beloved pitch, the training ground of dreams, has had a facelift.
It certainly has. We have got a new AstroTurf Training Pitch that will be available for sale from Monday. So we'll be taking you through that, showing you some of the great exercises you can do on it, and hopefully setting up the new Subbuteo Challenge.
The Subbuteo World have released two new AstroTurf pitches, and these are different. And my good friend Keith and I will be having a flick around with these later on in the programme.
We will, and on top of that, a lovely, lovely feature we have for you today. Our special guest is Stan Cullimore from the Housemartins, and he's coming in to talk about this greatest hits Housemartins box set. I have a sneaky feeling you're going to enjoy that. Now, some of you may remember it was my plan to do a four-part series on the evolution of Subbuteo rules, but I have changed my mind, hopefully for something that is going to be a little more racy. We are going to do a two-parter. The first part will be coming up shortly, that will still cover the evolution of Subbuteo rules. But running parallel to that, we are going to have a look at the intrigue, the arguments, the infighting of the various associations and federations that have popped up and disappeared over the last 73 years. That should be rather interesting.
But as is tradition on TFM, we're going to kick off with the prize draw. And so here to declare the winner, it's over to
Daniel!
Yes, thanks Keith. And look at this, he let me have my very own table, all designed by me. Well, except the cloth and the telephone. The rest was me though. Anyway, back to the competition. 299 of you entered this month and 299 of you got it right. I did wonder why I couldn't get on Google. Anyway, because so many of you entered, it was going to be impossible to write down all of your names. So we are going high tech. I've got my mobile phone and we're going to use a random number generator, which you'll be able to see through this camera here. Keith's got all of your entries in a file on his laptop and we'll match the number to the entry. So the question we asked you was, which goalkeeper had the nickname Black Spider? And of course, you knew the answer. It was the Russian legend and hunk, Lev Yashin. Well done to all of you that entered. Are we ready to see who that lucky winner is? Here goes. So, let's bring it through to the control room. I do hope he's still there.
Yes?
Houston, we have a number. 3 and 4, 34.
We have a match.
Fab. Got it. I told you it'd be better this way. Right, before we go on, I need to make an apology on behalf of Keith. Last month, Tracy Waite was unfortunately missed in the competition entry. So, that would have been okay. Things happen, but not when you've got your grandsons watching with you. So, on behalf of Keith and the rest of us here, really sorry about that. Noah and Dylan, please keep watching. Okay, now, the winner of this month's competition is... number 34, Torin Reed. Well done, Torin. Well done, Torin. Congratulations. You have got this fantastic prize, AC Milan and Inter Milan from Zugo. Keith will be in touch in the next couple of days and then they'll be on their way to you. Let's see them in action. So that's it for this month's prize draw. Thank you so much for entering. And don't forget, there'll be a new competition at the end of the programme. Now, interview time!
There have been numerous weird things that have happened over the time we have been making Table Football Monthly. But today, potentially, the weirdest, because we have a guest.
Woohoo!
Using the term loosely. Yeah, Stan Cullimore here, and I go back 1990, Merlin the Magical Puppy. Good grief. How many years is that?
30 years.
We go back 30 years. And in that time, we've done kids' telly, we've done books, canal walks, this.
Slot car, did a lot of slot car stuff. But we have done a lot of stuff.
We have done. We've
30 years.
Couple of old cackers getting here to wax lyrical about olden days. But no, it's far more exciting than that. Genuine Subbuteo fans amongst you will know that unlike other table football games, Subbuteo never had celebrity endorsements. And yet, sitting next to me is one of the, in fact, I think the only celebrity, I can't believe I just said that out loud, the only celebrity...
I'm sorry, I didn't hear that, Keith. What did you say I was again?
He's going to torture me, I knew it. The only celebrity ever to be on a Subbuteo box. We have it here. The Housemartins Subbuteo edition. Now, I'm going to try and like this, but I can't. And do you know why? You've all been through this. You know where your mate's done something that you would dream of? Stan has done this, and I haven't. And you know what? He doesn't even know the relevance. Inside this box is a Subbuteo poster. I'm going to show you a close-up of this. With the Housemartins, God bless them, Subbuteo. They're on a Subbuteo poster. Something that's never going to happen to me. Be careful.
Does
with
it?
That.
Oh, it actually says the Housemartins.
It does.
Do you know what? I have signed some of these. You know.
Irritating. See, yeah. Irritating.
But you're absolutely right. I have no, and I definitely don't remember. I don't remember that photo shoot, so I'm not sure if it actually happened.
Look,
it may not have been real, Keith.
Look.
I had to puncture the bubble, but it may not be real.
It is real.
Fine. It's real.
Look how fresh-faced you all are. You got any idea when that was?
Not a clue. In the 80s. I'm going to go 80s with that one.
Another detailed and informative interview on Table Football.
I did try and warn Keith. I have a very, very poor memory because I have abused my body by drinking far too much tea and eating far too many biscuits over the last nearly 60 years. And
metaphorical.
And it, no. Very tasty. Either way, they were very tasty. And I have damaged myself. So I can't remember stuff yet. I'm not an expert, Keith. But I don't think that's actual life size for Subbuteo players, is it?
No, it's not. It's a larger version, Stan. Well done. Very insightful.
I've watched the channel. I know a bit. So is that a heavyweight or a lightweight?
Actually, it's very light for its size.
Whoa! Now, did you break it?
No, I didn't break it.
Give
me a second.
Do you know what? I think secretly he's jealous. He's jealous. Oh, my goody arm. He's destroyed it. You know, when you were a kid and you had your precious things and your mate would come round and destroy them because he was jealous that you had precious things and he didn't. I think you've just done it, haven't you, Keith?
This is a Hull City player.
Is it?
Now, what should come flooding back is you had an album out with Housemartins.
We did. Yes, this is true.
London 0, Hull 4. So, we have the whole thing. We have some Housemartin badges.
Oh, I used to love these badges. What do they call them? Pins or lapel badges?
Pins is American.
But yeah, I used to love those badges.
I only noticed when I knew you were coming in that two of them are missing. Look, the two.
Oh, are they?
There's two bits of glue on there, so there's two.
Unless they've moved. Are the other ones moved, or are they?
Oh, that would be nice.
Oh, I can't remember. Yeah.
So, let's have a little think for a minute. Obviously.
Okay. Oh, think for a minute. You see what you did there? We had a hit. We had a single. I'm not sure it was a hit. But we had a single called Think for a Minute. Well done, Keith. Very good. Very good. It looks like he just makes it all up, but he doesn't. It's all scripted.
What I'm interested in...
He just mouthed root words, didn't he?
What I'm interested in knowing is, those fresh-faced chaps there, how did this come about? Because Paul is affecting a very decent flick there.
Ooh, I admire his sleuthing skills. Keith, you are nobody's fool. Mr. Lillia, if I'm honest, dare I say this, well, I'll be asked to leave. Maybe this may be the last thing you hear me say on camera. I didn't play Subbuteo myself as a child. It's all right, I've got my coat. I knew you wouldn't like it, but Paul did, I believe. I seem to remember he talked about it. So I'm guessing the connection was, obviously, we were known as a football band, so we used to play football, your actual football. And I rather suspect Paul liked Subbuteo. Because like I'm sure a lot of your viewers, and like you, he loved detail and loves details. So I think, well, like any human being with a pulse, who's male, would come in this place and salivate, quite frankly. So yeah, so Paul, I think Paul liked that sort of thing. So I presume it was his connection, somehow it was the Subbuteo thing. But in truth, can I tell him the truth about this?
Yeah.
What it was, the whole thing was a bit of a marketing ploy, not by Subbuteo that I'm aware of, but by the record company. We had a greatest hits CD, which I noticed is not in the box. I think Keith actually used it as an ashtray many years ago. He says it just flicked a kick. Yeah, he's probably saying, yeah, I don't care about you, Stan, and your silly nonsense. But we had a greatest hits CD, which came in the box, but it did quite well, better than I think the record company expected. And so I think this whole thing, I suspect it was because the football thing or because Paul, they probably said, hey, should we do a Subbuteo link up? So I think they did a few thousand, I can't remember the number, 10,000, 20,000 of these. And I know they sent me some through, which I gave away. And you know what I found out? Which breaks my heart. I thought I gave one to Keith. I presumed that I gave this to Keith because I was given like half a dozen or something. And he said, no, Stan, you didn't. I had to buy it myself.
Correct.
So I feel really bad.
Then I would have the CD. I've got no idea what happened to that. Now, what makes this doubly...
Sorry, I'm still feeling really bad that you had to buy it. I didn't give it to you. Sorry. Yeah, but yes.
Right, you're forgiven. Okay. Now, what I'm interested in. Undertones did a song, My Favourite Cousin.
Yes.
Had Subbuteo in the title.
Yes.
I think Half Man, Half Biscuit. All I Want for Christmas is Duke of Prague Away. Because Subbuteo's on here, big and yellow, I'm guessing Subbuteo were happy to have your four mugs.
I said I don't remember any discussion with Subbuteo. I remember there was a discussion with the record company, and basically, again, I'm afraid it was. I just thought, yeah, whatever, you know, my input literally was, can I have some freebies? And they're like, yeah, of course you can. I was like, yeah, I'm up for it then.
Freebies are good.
I'll be honest though, again, I know, look, I have loved being here. So there was a comment, because I've also watched some of the shows. Don't tell him that I also watch and enjoy, and I've subscribed to the channel. So I watch the shows, and I've loved being here. It's been incredible. I saw in a comment someone somewhere described this shed or studio as a palace to table football. I have to say, it really is. It's pretty awesome. So I enjoyed it. Shed. What is it? A studio or a...
Actually, you know what? The truth of the matter is it's a warehouse.
Studio. A warehouse.
But I prefer studio.
It's a studio. No, I prefer palace.
A palace.
This to me is this... Hang on. If I was... Not that I'm the sort that would ever live in a palace. But if I lived in a palace, I wouldn't want a sort of stuffy, big, drafty, horrible place. I want something like this filled with things I love and enjoy. As you love and enjoy them, Keith.
Well, what I promised...
I have to say that or else it'll hit me. It's also true.
What I have to do, because I promised everybody on the Facebook group page, to stick with the Housemartins for a minute. There is one thing that I have always loved. I have to say that.
Whoa. Where's this going?
No. Because I think when I look at some of the self-indulgent videos of the 80s, And they were good, don't get me wrong. If you look at Vienna or you look at some of the Duran Duran, Rio and so on. Then you look at the video for Happy Hour. It's the dancing. I love the dancing on that video. I love it more than I can tell you.
Is that perhaps because it's not that good?
It's because it's excellent. What I want to know is that was not thought of in a minute, because your syncopation together is glorious. So come on, who said, lads, I've got a great idea, let's stand there and do this dancing?
Do you know what, I'll my giddy arm. It's because I know you have a Shadows connection. He probably doesn't mention it, but he has a connection with the Shadows, as in Cliff Richard and. And so Paul and I started out by busking. And so it's just me and a guitar, Paul with a trombone in those days, and us two singing. I know, exactly.
I know,
don't even ask. But so we got rid of the trombone pretty quickly, and you got a harmonica. But then it came to songs, you want a bit in the middle where you want a harmonica or a solo. You don't, and I can't play guitar solo if I'm also playing the rhythm guitar, and I can't play solos. So we literally had to say, what do we do? And so we used to do dance solos. Paul would do a dance solo, and then I'd do a sort of, then we'd do a Shadows-esque sort of the same thing. And so I think it was a bit of a tongue-in-cheek thing. On stage, Norman and I would join in and either do that Shadows, you know that weird sort of Shadows type dance, that where they sort of step.
The square. Yeah.
Or we do that weird dance. It was almost like, I said, tongue-in-cheek. Paul's doing a solo, so we do it in the back, you know, we do it together. It was all done for sheer joy. And on there, we just sort of, again, did it, thought, well, it's just, why not? I think it's just one of those things that occurs to you when you get bored. The truth is, you're busy, you arrive, so you've got 8 hours of filming, and you're thinking, oh, man. So to keep the activity level up, if Paul or someone said, hey, should we do a dance? It's like, yes, that'll be fun.
I'm going to jump forward. Stan and I, a lot of you won't know this, and with very good reason, but in around about 2010, we ended up doing a kids show together called The Bops. Now, what's interesting is, in one of those episodes, the Nickelodeon producer asked us if we could dance.
I remember.
I'm sure we both said no.
Well, I'm sure I said yes. I have been a professional dancer, but please don't look at my work.
So we were sent to a dancing school to become experts within an afternoon, I think. Which, of course, we did. I'm going to show a clip of that dancing.
Okay, I remember embracing the experience and the knowledge that I would look foolish. And I seem to remember, Keith, a certain person, that would be Keith, was less than happy with the knowledge they were going to end up dancing on camera and looking a bit foolish.
I must admit, I didn't enjoy it until the day we actually did it, because typical of us, we forgot the last bit. And the last bit
That rings true.
The last bit is improvised. So what I want you to do, I'm just going to show you this dance sequence. I know it's got nothing to do with football, but as we're here, because it is dancing that really shows strictly how it should be done. And please be aware that the last 10 seconds or so was choreographed by Mr. Stan Cullimore. Whistling the ladder song. Hey, hey. I'm on top of my wooden. I'm a window cleaner, call me a vision technician. I will bring a shine to all your see-through walls. He cannot resist it. He's got his face on a Subbuteo poster and he can't resist it.
Mm.
It
is... I have film star good looks, can't you see?
So imagine that, having your face on a Subbuteo. Do you know, all of us would be looking at that thinking, oh, I'd love that.
Oh, hang on a minute, Keith. If you had your photograph taken next to me, you know when they go to Star Trek conventions, they charge money to have photographs taken next to the actors. I think you should pay me with at least two biscuits for you being next to me if you get a photograph.
Well, this is me with famous Stan of the Subbuteo poster.
I'm only asking two biscuits. Come on. Good. Actually, to be fair, he gave me tea and toast earlier, so you know what? This is on me, have you?
Right, well, that about wraps it up For one of our more colourful guests, it's got to be said, mostly we do table football.
I have noticed, and I enjoy, and you know what, I hope you don't have too many guests, quite frankly, because I like the table football.
Well, I have certainly enjoyed it. It's been great having Stan back in the studio again. And normally, when we're in a studio together, there's somebody shouting at us to get on and do something. It's been really nice just to sit around and not be told.
We should dance. Next, I'll tell you what, next, if you want to see Keith dancing, but again, comments or whatever it is they do, sorry. Yeah, oh, we're getting a comment through saying, yes, I'd like to see Keith dancing, please. Can he put his bops outfit on? Signed, someone who watches Tabletop Monthly. Yes. There you go.
Now, muddy pitches will be withdrawn. All free gifts and competitions will be withdrawn if anybody asks for that.
Can I tell them how nice it feels, the muddy pitch, by the way? It really does. Yeah, I was feeling... does everyone do this? Subbuteo people. I was feeling the pitches.
Danielle does.
Some of them are really nice, and that was a very nice one to feel.
It is quite soft. I was said that.
Sorry.
I was ending this before you...
Sorry.
Yeah, so
I made it weird.
Do you know what? We're just going to end this because it'll just carry on. And we're going to carry on yakking as we walk to the door. So, Stan, a million thank yous. It's been really good to see you.
Thank you. I'll leave now before I say anything else.
I hope you've enjoyed it. I've got to go and show them out because I locked the door. Happy hour again.
As you can see, being the fitness fanatics that we are, we're all set up and ready to play counterattack.
But we have stumbled upon a small problem. As you can see, it's a board-based game where you get to select your squad based on their abilities in the arenas of heading, passing, shooting. And it looks dreadfully exciting.
However, the game is 45 minutes each way.
Allied to that, we're only just learning the rules. So it has dawned on us that we are going to film the game, we're going to play it now, but we're not going to be able to do that. Edit down the clips and put it into this month's edition. So we're going to go ahead and play it, we're going to film it, and we will stick it into the October edition. And I promise you, it will be worth seeing.
Yeah, because Keith's going to get a thrashing.
Remember those words. Finally, our muddy pitches have arrived. 16 rolls of them. Finally, after all these weeks, I am now in possession of the Football Monthly muddy pitches. 16 rolls of them. Tomorrow, what's today? Saturday. Saturday the 3rd of October. So tomorrow, Danielle and I begin the process of cutting up the individual pitches. Now on the roll, we'll be cutting them long ways. We're going to leave white strips around the edges. If you don't want those, you will be able to cut them quite easily. This material will not fray. Just make sure you use sharp scissors. Or you can keep them, because if you're going to pin the table down, then you can use the white strips to do so. I've mentioned before on our Facebook group and at various times in previous programs that the list of people who've announced an interest to own one of these pitches is oversubscribed. But inevitably, things change and not everybody is going to go through with their purchase. So first of all, just to be clear, this week I will email everybody on that initial list to give you the opportunity to purchase the pitch. Initially, I told you all it'd be going out at £50. Well, I'm afraid it's gone up. It's going to be going out at 54 because of some additional costs that have come through and the fact that the cutting is a far bigger job than we thought. But it's £54 and payment will be via PayPal unless we discuss with each other some other way that's more convenient. But PayPal is ideal. Once I've gone through that list, I will then move on to our backup list and contact as many of those people as I can to pick up the slack. But I want to make it clear, this run of pitches will be the only run. There will be no reprint. What I will do, if it becomes possible, and we're looking into the technology, I will bring out an AstroTurf version when the technology exists to do this level of 3D printing, this photorealistic effect on AstroTurf. But at the moment, that technology doesn't exist without ruining the flock of the Astro. So the pitches we have will be the only ones because it's just a time-consuming process and I have to pay all of this up front and I won't be doing it again. The pitch is a very, very thin nylon. Now what I have done, it was very important to me that the pitch did not run too fast. Those of you that own the Subbuteo Netcam UEFA Champions League cotton pitches and the Winter Edition Snowy Pitch will know that those pitches run very fast. As a clogged up muddy pitch, I didn't want that. So this pitch has been regulated to run neutral. The ball will not run and run and run. Equally, a certain amount of resistance has been designed into the pitch to stop the players sliding forever and forever. Because if the pitch were real and cloggy, then that wouldn't be the case. If you do want the players to slide and slide, then simply add a bit of polish. And to be honest, that can be simple household polish or one of the more refined tabletop football polishes. If you do polish, remember, once you've applied the polish, use a clean cloth to get rid of any residue. There will be an information sheet that comes with the pitch, but when it arrives, do not fix your goals with a drill. The pitch is so thin, it'll wrap itself around your drill bit. So if you do want to drill your goals in, drill into the table first and then put a pin or some sharp object through the pitch, or you'll end up with a hole I created there. The pitch will lie flat. This hasn't been ironed. This is straight off the roll and straight onto the table. It's so soft, it lies flat quite easily. Unlike some cloth pitches, this will not adhere like Velcro to an Astro pitch. I have this on an Astro now, and it isn't stuck. But it lies flat pretty well. In fact, it lies flat very well. So you can either pin it down, or as I've done here, just leave it, because it doesn't skag. As you can see, I can move players around. My fingers don't skag the table. It all works smoothly. So you shouldn't have any problem with creases. If, however, you decide you're going to give it an iron, remember, do not have the iron on a hot setting. Have it on its lowest setting. Iron the reverse of the pitch. And remember to put a cloth or a tea towel between the iron and the pitch. Otherwise, you're going to have a smoking pitch. So in conclusion, we will be in touch with you this week if you have dropped us an email to announce your interest in the pitch. When I do so, it'll have the revised price, which is now £54. And I apologise for that, but costs have got to be covered. Do remember, if you're feeling a little bit glum about that, this is a bespoke pitch from start to finish. This was designed with the help of an art department to create this realistic finish. And it was based on grounds such as the baseball ground, Ibrox and Ellen Road. So a lot of effort from a lot of people has gone into it. So £54 is reasonable, I hope you'll agree. There will be a cost for postage, which I will work out for each country. So once you get your email, let me know if you still want it. We'll agree a way for you to transfer the loot, and the pitch will be on its way to you in a sealed and secure bag. If you do not get that email this week, please do not panic. I can't actually work that quickly as I'm on my own. But you will be notified if you were on that original list. Once those people are full, hopefully by the end of this week, I will have had people come back and either not reply or decline to proceed, in which case I will get onto the second list and let you know. If there's any pitches left after that, then I will just announce that on our Facebook group and in next month's edition. Now, this has all got a bit serious and a bit grown up, so I think we need to finish this segment on a lighter note. If you have a look at these two teams, you'll see they have been muddied up. But underneath that mud, these are Newcastle United and Hereford. Newcastle in the red and Hereford. In the 1972 FA Cup, Newcastle, a high-flying First Division side, had drawn the first game at home to non-league Hereford. The replay, having been postponed a couple of times, was held at Edgar Street, the first ever game that John Motson was to commentate on for the BBC, and one of the greatest and the most famous cup giant killing acts followed. So what I thought we'll do, as we've muddied up these players, we'll recreate that match with a little bit of original footage thrown in to show you the muddy pitch in action. So here you have Hereford United versus Newcastle, 1972.
Well, on this important day in Hereford's history, they're sitting on walls, on floodlight pylons, and even in trees to get a view of this match. Now Green. Busby. Three in the penalty area. McDonald coming in. That's it. Radford. Now Tudor's gone down for Newcastle. Radford again. Oh, what a goal! What a goal! Radford the scorer. Ronnie Radford. And the crowd. The crowd are invading the pitch. And now it will take some time to clear the field. Radford. Tyler. George. Oh, he's got it! Ricky George! Ricky George has done it! What a moment for Hereford!
Subbuteo World, via their brand Pegasus of Yorkshire in England, are releasing two new AstroTurf pitches this week. Now you may be asking yourself, as there are so many pitches about, why am I kneeling in reverence to this particular AstroTurf? Well, the truth is I'm kneeling so that my face fits on the camera and you can still see the pitch. But I would kneel anyway, because this is not any old Astro pitch. This is new, or AstroTurf, I should say. What's new about it? We'll have a look on the back. You'll all be aware that AstroTurf pitches are PVC backed. Well, when you have a look at this one, you will see that the PVC is very, very thin. Now that means this pitch lies flat almost instantly. This pitch has been down for an hour, having been taken out of a tube. And look at it, it is like a bowling green. I absolutely love it. And the second reason I love this pitch is the flock. This is a new kind of AstroTurf. It's come from Europe. It's been a long time coming. And it is the softest, nicest feeling AstroTurf I've ever come across, even going back to the Subbuteo AstroTurf of the 80s. Now, what this brings as an additional pleasant surprise is the ball is really running neutral. One of my problems with a lot of new Astro pitches is the ball rolls away like a rocket and you're stood there with binoculars wondering where the hell it's gone. This pitch is about as neutral as can be. The roll is true and the ball is neutral. I love that. So much easier to control. The players slide beautifully, as you'd expect, and these haven't been polished. So we have this new flock. We have the stripes going across the pitch. I mentioned there were two. I'm not going to lay the second one down because there's no point, as they're fundamentally the same. But the second pitch is a circular pattern. There you see it. But the same flock, the same thin PVC backing. So let's have a little play. I get asked from time to time, or the assumption is made, that I have some kind of link with Subbuteo World in Yorkshire. Well, I've known Pete and Sandra for a long, long time. And when I first started the ball rolling with Table Football Monthly and my documentaries in 2017, Pete was an immense help. So other than valuing their friendship, we have no commercial tie-ins at all. So, when I say I really love this pitch, I am under no obligation to Subbuteo World to say so, and I don't receive any kind of payment. I don't receive a payment from any of the people who submit products to this programme. So, yes, I do like it. I like it because the flock is gorgeous. I like it because the ball has a genuine roll. It doesn't go whizzing anywhere. And I like it for one other reason that you may have noticed, or you may not. Don't go away. Ever since Subbuteo released their AstroTurf in the 80s, AstroTurfs have tended to be this dark green colour. So look at the difference with this AstroTurf. Once you see it for the first time, you realise that this is a realistic grass colour. This is not. This is more of a British Racing green colour. And this goes for many Astro pitches. To see a pitch in this much lighter colour is fantastic, both from a playing viewpoint, but just aesthetically, I really like it. So, I would and will recommend it, whether or not I can fire this one in. Yeah, I'll recommend it. Rules, love them or hate them, create a framework by which consistency and fluency can be brought into playing a game. Sometimes those rules are quite simple and straightforward, and at other times, less so. By 1952, Peter Adolf Subbuteo had been available for 5 years. He'd found getting the startup rules dead easy, because he simply copied word for word the rules from New Footy. So let's have a quick look at those basics. Your player could touch the ball 3 times before another player had to take over. You lost possession if the ball hit an opposing player, or if you missed it. A goal was a goal if you shot from the right area of the pitch and the ball went into the net. Well, nothing too difficult or complicated there for the likes of us. Now, Peter Adolf was a very clever man. He had realised already that the best source of new cash was to go back to existing customers, either through accessories or by providing additional teams. But for 1 shilling, you could get this red booklet, Advanced Subbuteo Table Soccer. Now you'll notice this does not say Advanced Table Soccer Rules. What it is a book about nothing. It's very clever. It's got pictures in, it talks to you about tactics, it talks about the importance of honour between players and how to set up your favourite team. But never want to miss a trick, it also includes instructions on how you can join our first association, the Table Soccer Players Association. So let's put that up on our board, association number 1, the Table Soccer Players Association. And all that needed was for you to send an extra 2 shillings. But let's be fair, for that you got a certificate, you got a badge, and in 1952, walking into school in your baggy shorts, your V-neck jumper, and your Subbuteo club badge would have been a cool look. We can believe that. Okay, so we don't have advanced rules, but what we are going to do is have a look at these rules because they are going to provide the springboard for the rest of the story. Let's go back in time. Before the game can begin, we have the toss of the coin. Now, at this stage, the toss is to decide ends. The Blues have won, they have decided they will defend the end nearest the camera. The Reds, therefore, get the kickoff. We are also following rule 16G, which is if the referee decides our formations do not resemble those of genuine association football, he can ask us to change them. Well, our Blues are 2-3-5, the traditional 50s setup. Our Reds are being a bit more racy and they're 4-2-4. Right, because we're back in the 50s, the kickoff. The player can only kick the ball once and it has to travel forwards. Now, what you may want to do, because when you get into your opponent's half, they can take alternate defensive flicks, three of them, you might want to not only kick the ball forward, but try and make use of your striker with a follow-through move. So maybe we can hit the ball forward and try and spin our striker into a good advanced position. Okay, he didn't get all that far, but that's okay. Right, we're underway, but let's get this into perspective. Immediately post-war, the rise in football attendances was astonishing, but let's be honest, there wasn't much else to do. So what was Peter Adolf looking for, both in his invention, Subbuteo, and the creation of the rules? Well, clearly, he'd seen the opportunity to build a business. So what he wanted to do was create rules within his game that encouraged youngsters from 8 to 12 to not only want to play, but to come back for accessories and additional teams. So to do that, he has tried to make his rules follow those of real association football as much as he can. And the best of those for these young lads who were just learning how to play was the rule that when you were in your own half, your opponent could make no blocking moves or make any moves to interfere with your progress. The reason this is clever is for these new players, in their own half, they had a chance to be expansive, to express the new skills in flicking and spinning they were developing, and it wasn't until you got into your opponent's half that your opponent could unleash his defensive blocks. Right, so let's have a little bit of self-indulgent play in our own half. Any wonder that Peter Adolf found himself with a roaring success of a table football game when, as a youngster, with 5, 4, or even 3 passes, as we showed at the end there, you could dismantle your opponent's team setup and put yourself a goal up. Until, of course, it was your opponent's go and he could do the same right back to you. So you were dependent on your goalkeeping skills. Now, that's not to say that blocking doesn't have a part in Subbuteo. Of course it does, and it's fantastic fun. But where again, I think Peter Adolf knew what he was doing, his rule enabled the defence to have 3 flicks, but only in their own half, alternate flicks to the attacker. Now what that meant was, you had to think, when were you going to use them? When was the opportune moment to use them to prevent your opponent getting a shot on goal? Whereas these days, your opponent can follow you around like a shadow. Too often, you end up with little ticky-tacky moments in the corner with a whole collection of players. It's not very interesting to watch. It's not the game that Peter Adolf invented. And for me, I don't find it all that exciting, and I've reached an age where it begins to hurt my back. So let's see blocking the way that Subbuteo intended it in action. Again, in an effort to make Subbuteo reflect real association football, The ball had to be in the shooting area, completely in the shooting area, for you to have a shot at goal. And you could only use a player that was in your opponent's half. Difference from then to now is that with polish and flat bases, or even with lightweight bases, you can flick a player the length of the field. What that has led to is the six-man line of defense you see so often in the more modern sliding game. You've got to protect your goal against that all the time. Well, that isn't a reflection of real association football. Here, you've got to be in the half, and as long as the ball is in the shooting area, you can have a pop at goal. Another fabulous rule in this early booklet was all about creating goals, which, let's face it, is what football should be about. And it was the cool shooting rule. If you were inside the shooting line, some of the pitches didn't have one of those, so you could mark one. If you were inside the shooting line and you fancied your chances, you could call shooting. The minute you did that, your opposing player could not block. Now, that is a cool rule because, one, it mimics the notion of a first-time shot in the real game. And secondly, it gives you a chance to create goals, which is something we all want. Shooting. If, however, when you line the shot up, you suddenly find yourself thinking, I don't know if that angle's good, you can revert and think, no, I'm not going to shoot, at which point your opponent's blocking moves can start again. For a corner, the attacking side can have three positional flicks. Always good to have one in the centre. We'll bring one of our chaps a bit nearer to the ball and another chap on the edge of the penalty area. For the Reds, oh, we've missed our first bit of marking. So we've not done bad, but we have left the far post looking a little naked. That's where the mischief may be. Half decent placement. Not a perfect angle for our man, but we'll take that. An important rule to remember when taking a goal kick. If the ball travels from your defensive area here all the way to the shooting area in your opponent's half, then possession of the ball transfers to your opponent. That happens irrespective of what the ball may do en route. So if it ricochets off one of your players or an opponent's player, if the ball ends up in the opposing area, then possession is lost. So if you're going to play long, you have got to be accurate. Sadly for us, we have gone just over the line. Otherwise, it would have been a good ball. Possession transfers to the Blues. So we'll go relatively short. Put the player back on his wire. Well, we'll place it there for now. Now, what are we going to do? We've got ourselves a bit of a through ball. As we said before in the rules, a player can take a shot if the ball is in the shooting area, so long as the player is in the opposing half. Slightly ambitious. And the keeper pushed it onto the post, but we're in. For corners, free kicks and throw-ins, your opponent is not allowed to be any nearer to the ball than 6 inches. We look pretty safe here. Both teams on a throw can flick one player for positioning. The important thing to remember for the thrower is he is not allowed to cross the white line onto the field of play. That's worked pretty well. A free kick in the shooting area is direct. The Blues have already had their three moves. The Reds have theirs. No opposing player is allowed closer than 6 inches to the ball, and there is nothing in the rules about building a wall. 1950s offside couldn't be more straightforward. If an attacker has only one opposing player between himself and the goal, then he's offside, as long as he's in the shooting area. Simple. As the end of the 50s approached, everything in the Subbuteo garden was rosy. The post-war economic situation in Britain was on the up, and so was Peter Adolf's company. Subbuteo was still primarily a mail order company, but the number of teams was growing, the number of accessories was growing, but most importantly, so were the number of players. New people were coming to the game, whilst those fledgling players that joined the Table Soccer Players Association in the late 40s were now young students. There were clubs in streets, in families, in schools, and now at colleges and universities. Peter Adolf was a very happy bunny, and he was very happy to see his game being taken more seriously. So yes, he hadn't got everything he wanted. He still wanted to establish a UK retail network. He was not selling in Europe, but all of this was becoming ever more possible. And yet, there were dark clouds on the horizon, and they took the form of something that may surprise you, something today we very much take for granted, and that was the arrival of OO-scale plastic figures. And here they are, the gorgeous 1961 OO-scale plastic figures, or as we now tend to refer to them, the old heavyweights in their gorgeous green boxes. When these were released in 1961, they were a revelation, and obviously they were, because for young kids coming into the game, Stanley Matthews, Tom Finney, these were players from an old era in baggy shorts. Even the Subbuteo flats stood to attention with their rather boring shirt, and their long baggy shorts didn't inspire the imagination. These, in their real Technicolor kit, were the real thing. Jimmy Greaves, Dennis Law, Johnny Haynes. They were an instant winner, except for the older players. Of course, they tried this new equipment, but they found it clunky, clumsy, unpredictable. The players didn't chip. They were as far away from the elegant, well-balanced, chippable flats that they were used to. They were not going to buy in to this. They were going to steadfastly remain flats players. Now, Peter Adolf didn't see a problem. He was happy to sell anything to anybody. He continued to make the flats. Each time there was a new kit for the OO scale players, he made exactly the same one for the flats. He kept both sides happy, but with the benefit of hindsight, we're seeing the beginning of a split between more senior players taking the game seriously, treating it more as a scientific sport, and the new breed of player coming in at entry level with enthusiasm, needing the basic rules, just wanting to play something that looked like football. But it was a small crack that was about to get bigger. For the first couple of years after the release of these gorgeous OO scale plastic figures, there was relative peace and harmony in the Subbuteo universe, but it was not the same on the European continent. Subbuteo had yet to establish a bona fide European distribution network, but there were still players, a growing number of them. They tended to be more mature, and they were unquestionably flats players. They too had tested the newfangled plastic figures and found them to come up short in terms of their technical value, their sliding value, their chipping value. They were not for changing. They were going to strictly remain flats. And in 1963, 2 years after these chaps came out, they formed the European Table Soccer Federation. Now, these chaps were terribly decent. They weren't looking to cause any bother, and they weren't going to operate a closed-door policy. So they allowed in all playing equipment. But let me tell you, and this is well explained on Peter Upton's Subbuteo tribute site, when two players of equal skill met on the table, it was always the one with the flats who would win. These new players looked fantastic. The colour range was great. The pose of the figures was fantastic. The diving goalkeepers, For the young newcomers, they were absolutely perfect, but they played nowhere near with the predictable elegance that the flats did. And there was just no argument, something these days we might find difficult to believe. And so in 1963, we get our second association or federation to add to the board, the European Table Soccer Federation. Keep count now. In 1964, the ETF, the European Table Soccer Federation, created an annual tournament called the Europa Cup, and it was open to all player types. The top two players of member nations were invited, and year on year, it was the flats that were winning it. The Italians joined the fray, but in Italy, the game was dominated by Subbuteo distributor Adelio Parodi. Now, if that name means something to you, it is because the Parodi family created Zugo, the players and accessories we still see today. Parodi, of course, as a Subbuteo man, was stocking and selling the old heavyweights. And so the Italian representatives were taking these players to the Europa Cup, and they were not getting anywhere. And this remained the case throughout the 60s. Whatever they tried, the flats were still dominating tournament Subbuteo. In Britain, they could see this burgeoning association in Europe doing rather well. And so the British Table Soccer Association was formed. Let's add that to our list. We're now at three. And was affiliated to the ETF. This allowed British players to enter the Europa Cup, but all through the 60s, they didn't so much as make a semi-final. But it did affect the scene in Britain. For Subbuteo, the original Table Soccer Players Association had become a bit of a burden for the lads at Tunbridge Wells. There were a lot of clubs, there were a lot of tournaments, there was a lot of paperwork. So they were quite happy to see the development of the British Table Soccer Association. However, by 1967, you've got to keep up, this association split into its different national groups with Wales and Scotland. So we now had the English Table Soccer Association, and Subbuteo were happy to maintain their support of this new organisation. So much so that the original Table Soccer Players Association from 1947 was allowed to quietly wind down. Now this is where things start to get difficult and very complicated. 1966 was the year England won the World Cup, which was all very jolly. Interest in football spiralled. But alongside that, and Subbuteo was always trying to follow the real game, interest in Subbuteo went crazy, and it went crazy worldwide. Now this was good news and something Peter Adolf had desperately wanted. He now had retailers in the UK demanding product. He had buyers all over the world sending in orders, but he couldn't fulfill them. The company did not have the infrastructure to fulfill this new demand. And so investment was badly needed. And that was hard to find. It was to ultimately lead in 1968 to Waddington's buying Subbuteo. Now, alongside that, as a parallel, Subbuteo had relinquished the tournament side of the game to the players with the English Table Soccer Association. Well, when Waddington's bought the company, they saw straight away that Subbuteo had relinquished the part of the game that would really be of promotional value. Advertising these tournaments, promoting these tournaments, would bring new players to the game. So the newly formed English Table Soccer Association had quite an early battle on their hands. Waddington's, owning Subbuteo, wanted that control back. So we will pick this story up in part two next month. Regular viewers will know that when we launched Table Football Monthly back in July 2019, we ran a Subbuteo challenge every month, right up until the COVID outbreak last March. And we did it on a Subbuteo training pitch. Well, month after month, many of you would write in and say, Keith, where do we get our hands on one of these training pitches? And it was the old Subbuteo skill set, and sadly, they are exceedingly rare, and when they do pop up on auction sites, they tend to be a tad expensive. So, a few weeks ago, I rang Pete at Subbuteo World and said, look, I've got an idea. I'm creating a muddy pitch, but I want to create a training pitch to satisfy all the requests I get in my inbox. But I don't know much about astro pitches. Would you be interested in doing it with me? Well, thankfully, Pete said yes. Although, to be perfectly honest, he wasn't sure it would work and the interest would be that high. Well, I think we're about to prove him wrong. Here it is. The Table Football Monthly and Pegasus AstroTurf Training Pitch. Much like the Pegasus pitch we reviewed earlier, this is a thinner AstroTurf with a much thinner PVC backing. As a result, it lies beautifully flat. Hopefully you can see that through the camera. The mowing pattern is not only aesthetically very pleasing, it's a very helpful guide to measuring straight slides and distances. I love that. The yellow markings are nice and clear and replicate those that were on our Subbuteo challenge pitch. I have to say, I really love it. And to top it all, we've got that lovely lighter green. The lush texture of the flock provides great grip for spinning. A consistent surface for sliding, for shooting, free kicks, and chipping. The original Subbuteo skill set came with this manual, offering various exercises and different things you could practice. Not only good for serious players, but if you're a solo player, what better than a pitch like this, where you could set yourself different targets and try to beat them each day. Now, I'm not convinced that this booklet and its rather vague illustrations are particularly helpful. So what I'm thinking of doing is recreating it, but using photographs to illustrate the different exercises. If you think that would be interesting, let me know by getting in touch on our usual email address. If there's enough interest, I'll have a think about putting that together rather quickly. So, this training pitch goes on sale from Monday at $44.99, exclusively from Subbuteo World. So, if you're of a mind, log on to subbuteoworld.co.uk on Monday and grab one. Now, 100 have been printed. Now, unlike the muddy pitch, there isn't a limit. Pete will go to a reprint if necessary, but if you want to get your hands on one quick, then get up early on Monday morning and do so. I think they're gonna go pretty quick. It's competition time. Recently, a lot of you have been saying, Keith, the questions go too far back. I wasn't born until the 80s. Well, last month, we gave you all a chance by offering you a Googleable question, and 299 of you got it right. This month, we're doing something different. I guarantee all of you can enter, and I guarantee all of you will have a 1 in 5 chance of winning. The prize is worth entering for. This month's prize is a brand new training pitch, an AstroTurf training pitch. So what do you have to do? Well, watch carefully. Study these two angles carefully, the player and the ball. I have already played this shot. What you have to do to win the AstroTurf is tell me which of holes 1 to 5 does the ball go into. It definitely goes through one of them. but based on the positioning you can see, your knowledge of Subbuteo and your knowledge of angles, and for those of you who've watched me play for many months, tell me which hole did the ball go through? Get your entries in if you can, please, by October the 22nd. And the prize will be a new AstroTurf training pitch. We are just about at the end of the September edition of Table Football Monthly. And I have to say, this one's been rather jolly.
It really has, yeah. Do you want to know which bit was my favourite part?
Does it involve me?
Yes, the part where I modernised you.
Oh, the prize draw. The prize draw!
Yes, the new high-tech prize draw.
Do you know, this morning, we didn't know that was going to happen. I rang Danielle and I said we've got 299 correct entries. And we haven't got time to handwrite all those and scissor them all up and fold them all up. And you came up with your numbery diddly.
Random number generator.
How cool is that? How many YouTube shows have got a random number generator? Actually, you've done well there. On the subject of competitions, if you are going to enter, that was like a real smooth link, did you notice that? If you are going to enter this month's competition, and of course, we hope you do, then please remember, as a gentle reminder, to send your replies only to this email address here, info@tabletopyears.com. I know I say this every month, but please don't put your answers in the comment section below the video, because I've got to delete them and they won't be entered into the draw. And all of you glorious people who have kindly joined our Table Football Monthly Facebook group, don't mention it. It's got to stay a secret, hasn't it?
Yes.
Now, on the subject of the Facebook group, it's 2 months old now. It's got 900 and something or other members. It's turned out to be a very jolly and humorous place. We are normally talking about it every day.
We're really enjoying it.
Yeah, it's been really good. So if you would like to join this merry band of Table Football Warriors, then all you have to do is...
type in Table Football Monthly in the search engine on Facebook.
Danielle knows everything. If you have any problem doing that, just contact us at the email that was just on the screen and we'll send you a link. We've also got to say a very special, genuine special thank you to Stan Cullimore, me old mucker. It was really kind of him not only to travel down to the studio, but to put up such an entertaining interview.
Yes, certainly for me, seeing your dancing.
Not for dancing, that will never happen again. So thank you, Stan, we love that. And thank you also to Lily, who opened the show with the Don't Mind If I Do. Thanks, Lily, really kind. The last thing we have to tell you is so many of you have been very kind about the music on the programme, which you probably know is all produced and recorded in-house. So today, for our outro, you have a new nostalgia piece. I hope you like it. Let us know. The World Cup song will, of course, be back later on. Anything else?
I think you've covered it.
Wow, that's nice. It's the nicest thing you've ever said to me.
Now with the help of me, obviously.
It's because I've been modernised. I have been modernised. So, thank you very much for watching. We hope you've enjoyed the programme. We certainly have. And we will see you next month. Bye for now.